Good morning, delegates. It is my great pleasure to give this 45-minute talk on tibial shaft fractures. This is the last lesson in the IAOS biological course. This talk is dedicated to my close friend, Professor Sarmiento, who sent me large volumes of material for this talk. Before I presented this talk to you, I had shared the presentation PowerPoint with Professor Sarmiento, and it is what he said. The print is a little small, so I shall transcribe it on two slides and show you what he says. He says that for some time he suspected that sooner or later the place of non-surgical care of fractures will turn and the powerful orthopedic industrial complex driven by profit will surrender its claimed merits, which are wrong. And of course, the claim for such historical event will rest with people of the modern generation who understood biology more than metal. He feels that this should be published and we should write a definitive book on non-operative management. And based on the material gathered in this course, the Indian Academy will ensure that we produce definitely a printed material which acts as a definitive reference for non-operative treatment in orthopedics. This talk is on closed tibial fractures based on lifetime research by Professor Augusto Sarmiento, and his philosophy is very simple. The manufacturing industry of surgical implants presents a powerful and persuasive argument to use the equipment and instrumentation. Thus, non-operative treatment receives a stepmotherly treatment. We are now going to discuss or describe the current Sarmiento, Prakash, Divakar regime for all closed or open grade 1 or 2 tibial fractures treated by non-operative management. But certain disclaimers before the movie starts. This is not applicable in grade 3 compound fractures. Though I have treated a few grade 3 compound fractures by this method with excellent results. Not recommended when there is a bone loss or a bone gap. Not useful in displaced intra-articular fractures at knee and ankle, and certainly not for a fuzzy patient. In addition, I have a very specific list of exclusions which may not be found in a textbook. And these exclusions include cops, journalists, lawyers, IAS officers, judges, very important persons, corporate hospitals, insurance cases, or finally, when a surgeon has to pay his EMI in installments. When everybody else benefits in this world, why should a poor surgeon with a due EMI suffer by offering non-operative treatment when surgery will do him easy and quick fix results which satisfies the patient as well? This is a current Prakash Divakar Sarmiento regime where we first reduce the tibial fracture and apply a cast from metatarsal to mid-thigh for 4 to 6 weeks and make the patient walk from day 1 of application of the cast. Exactly after 6 weeks, we either apply a thermoplastic molded cast brace till union, and in case you are unfamiliar with thermoplastic bracing, it is recommended that you use a plaster gaiter made up of fiberglass or POP cast, which should be useful for the situation. In compound fractures, we make a window, and the key is the patient walks from day one, meaning put a long leg cast and make the patient walk. It is walking that unites the fracture, not the casting. The patient must not be lying on the bed, nor must the leg be lifted up, because that causes a recurvatum deformity. The patient must sit on a high stool, hanging his legs, giving us an opportunity to examine both legs and ensure that the fractured limb is brought to the same position as a non-fractured limb. As this slide will show us, if the cast is applied, but the leg is held from toes, a recurvatum will occur. What we must do, on the contrary, is to make the patient sit on a high table or high chair while the assistant gingerly holds the foot in neutral position, avoiding an equinus attitude, and ensure that gravity and manual manipulation reduces the fracture to the best of ability. We must ensure the rotation is corrected primarily, and the limb must be in a valgus orientation, not a varus orientation. Just two factors and you are through. And while the leg hangs freely over side of the table, after finishing from metacarpal to knee, we can then extend the leg and go up to the mid-thigh. We do not want too much of padding. A well-indexed cast is the key to a successful Sarmiento plaster or a Sarmiento method of managing a distal radial fracture. The completed above knee cast should not hold the knee in flexion. The patient is encouraged to walk on the cast from the first day of the fracture. And you can see that because the knee is in straight extension with just 5 degrees of flexion, and the leg is straight and the foot is plantigrade, the patient can bear weight. You can see in this x-ray the large amount of padding which has been applied over the mid-thigh and calf, and such excessive padding will invariably ensure that the limb displaces and the fracture is no longer in position, especially when the swelling has come down due to ambulation and walking, which improves the venous stasis of the limb. The next slides will show how to convert this into a below knee functional cast. After 4 to 6 weeks, when there is some radiological evidence of mild fluffy colors and the patient's pain is little less and the patient is able to walk properly, we convert this into a functional cast. The first thing is the patient should sit on a high table with the hip and knee flexed at 90 degrees. The assistant pulls the leg down and reduces the fracture, and then this is applied only on a stockinette without any soft roll or cotton or any additional padding. We can have a very thin layer of cotton padding, or we can have a stockinette alone. The assistant holds the leg in neutral rotation, and the plaster Paris material is rolled from toes to approximately 2 inches of the ankle joint. You can see that in this picture, the cast has been rolled up to the ankle joint, and then we are going to extend it up to the knee, restricting posteriorly up to the popliteal fossa. In case we cross the knee, we should not worry, because we will be always trimming the plaster to convert it into a proper PTEB or a patellar tendon bearing cast. Here you can see that the molding of the patellar tendon is one of the very important aspects, because the pressure of the patellar tendon both medially and laterally and contouring over the patella is being done. At this stage, the surgeon often retains the patient's foot on his thigh, and this helps him in ensuring that the plaster sets comfortably without loss of reduction. Once that is done, we have to trim the plaster by marking it with a marker pen, and a trim line in the proximal cast should be done in such a manner as to eventually permit full flexion and extension of the knee joint with an extension block superiorly to just above the patellar proximal pole of the patella, laterally as far as possible without interfering with the hamstring muscles, and posteriorly at the level of the opposite tibial tubercle. The clinical picture on the right shows the mild patellar indentation, how the patella restricts hyperextension and recurvatum tendencies, and how it provides as protection against rotational and angulation stresses by its precise plastering. This picture in the next slide shows that the firm contact between the wings of the cast and the femoral condyles assist in providing angular and rotatory stability. You can see the degree of flexion of the cast which permits. After this, you can see also that the heel has been put and the patient is allowed and encouraged to walk on this. In case the patient is not accepting a plaster, or you want to go or bypass the next generation, the idea here is to apply a plastic custom brace in the form of a thermoplastic sheet. For a thermoplastic sheet cast application, we first need to measure the girth of the leg from the level of the tibial tubercle to just above the ankle. The level at the tibial tubercle is the upper marking. The markings just below the ankle and at the condyles is the lower mark. Once these markings and dimensions are written down, we take a thermoplastic sheet, draw the appropriate lines, and using a marker pen, mark the thermoplastic sheet so that we know how much to cut and where to cut in this thermoplastic sheet. These sheets are available in 2 and 4 millimeter thicknesses with perforation for breathing. They are available on Amazon, and I shall be sharing the links of its availability in the group shortly. These normally become moldable and flexible when they are dipped in hot water at 80 degrees. One of the mistakes surgeons commonly do is to dip it in boiling water, which negates them to the near melting point of 120 degrees. You have to only heat the water up to 80 degrees. That is why, instead of boiling water in a basin, it is better to have a temperature controlled thermostatic bath, where with a digital thermometer and the markings, we can ensure that the temperature is maintained at 80 degrees. Once the plastic becomes a little flexible and cloth-like, the patient is told that it is going to be applied around his leg, he must be assured that it will feel a little warm, but it won't burn his skin, and the heat generated is probably less than the heat generated when you are applying a plaster Paris cast during its exothermic reaction. Now you can see that the sheet is folded over the leg. The patient himself is asked to hold the upper wing by his fingers close to his patella, while the thermoplastic splint is indexed around the leg and molded beautifully around the patient's leg. The assistant already has a crepe bandage soaked in water, which is now handed to the surgeon, who wraps it around the leg to closely contour the thermoplastic brace to the leg, and with two thumbs, the patella is pressed posteriorly, and the two sides of the patellar tendon are grooved together to get a patellar tendon bearing surface. You can see here that the cast is already set. In the initial times, Sarmento insisted on immobilizing the ankle too by giving an ankle support to control rotation, but of late, the philosophy has changed and the two distal wings on either medial and lateral side of the ankle are enough to ensure that rotation is not a problem, and I have stopped or abandoned the use of ankle support. The finished brace allows a reasonably full range of knee movement up to 90 to 100 degrees. There should be some space, and there should not be a lower cast which allows more than 120 degrees if it has to work with the Sarmento principle. In addition, Sarmento braces are also available prefabricated with Velcro strips made in two pieces for general use. They are available in extra small size suitable for children, the small size suitable for women and shorter men, the medium size, the large size, and extra large size, depending on the patient's height. And these can also be trimmed to ensure that they correspond to the knee. The procedure is the same. These are applied only after the fracture becomes sticky. The patient is seated on a high stool or a chair. The two legs are inspected, matched. A stockinette is rolled over the leg. The two parts of the cast brace are slid over the leg. The Velcro straps are anchored and tightened. The stability of the fracture is checked. We make angular, rotational, and compression tests to ensure that the cast brace is serving its function. And this slide shows how the patient is flexing his knee and using a crutch to weight bear and walk. Once the patient gets comfortable and familiar with the system, he does not need assistance to don and doff, meaning to remove and reapply the frame on his leg, and he continues to walk till the fracture finally unites. I hope the three steps are very clear. We have to start with a long leg cast, walking. After 4 weeks, when the fracture becomes sticky, we change to a well-molded Sarmento brace or a fiber cast or a gaiter cast on the leg. And then after another 2 weeks or 3 weeks, around 2 months stage, we can just change to a removable brace, which is changed during the night and patient bears weight during the morning. Based on these principles, we are now showing you the results in proximal tibia, middle tibia, distal tibia, compound grade 2 fractures, compound grade 3 fractures, and also giving our recommendations for the situations in which this fracture can be used, and also for acceptable limits of angulation and rotation. Here you can see a fracture of a proximal tibial fracture with minor side-to-side shift, walking from day one, and the fracture unites in 69 to 70 days, which is impossible with a nail or a plate. And you can see the patient's clinical picture, knee flexion to full, and both legs look identical. Another proximal tibial fracture, again there's a slight shift, again it unites beautifully. These fractures would have normally been nailed, and then somebody would forget to dynamize, or it might get infected and may cause problems. Comminuted fractures are actually better, especially those are in valgus, and they heal really beautifully with good hypertrophic callus in a very short while, as shown by this patient and this subsequent patient, again with large combination, almost extending up to proximal intra-articular area, doing so beautifully by plain conservative management. We can see how well and how beautifully and to what extent his knee bends. Another case of a comminuted fracture of both tibia and fibula in the proximal third has been cast in slight valgus, and the last photograph of the patient's face clearly shows how much of flexion the patient has achieved. One more example. No, I think I better go to mid-shaft fractures. Let's now start with mid-shaft fractures. Here is a middle shaft of tibia in a young lady treated by a long leg cast, walking from day one, and unites in 85 to 90 days. And you can see the amount of flexion and the position of the limb in the photograph on the right. One more patient with a comminuted mid-shaft tibia, which would have been under the normal course treated by intramedullary nailing, has been done and dusted with Sarmiento Prakash Divakar methods, and there you find the patient with excellent function, kneeling down, Christian who wants to kneel down. One more grade 1 compound fracture, you can see how beautifully it unites. This person had a very small window for dressing, and the amount of abundant callus you see in such a short while can neither be seen by a plate or by a nail. Another oblique tibial fracture, comminuted along with the fibular fracture, immobilized with slight valgus, neutral rotation, and you can see the level of knee joint, level of ankle joint is the same, and the fracture unites beautifully with abundant amount of callus. The same principles and theories also apply for distal tibial fractures. The principle is, using gravity methods, we reduce the tibia by making the patient sit on a table, and this young lady had a cast for just 30 days followed by a brace, you can see on the right, and that is her in 90 days with a solid union. Despite union, the lady has been acclimatized to use the splint, so she is having it for her happiness. You can see such good results which no nail can even approach. An oblique distal tibial fracture, because of large surface area, heals beautifully. And here we must understand that larger surface area, more the combination and more the beds, faster and easier will it heal. This one is a terminal distal tibial fracture, oblique with gross valgus deformity and an external rotation deformity. We must understand that the best way to reduce is to apply forces opposite to the deforming forces, and the union is seen on the last picture. near anatomical union with a perfect alignment of the ankle joint. One more distal tibial fracture has united not only normally, but the patient is able to tiptoe and stand on a heel absolutely brilliantly. In such terminal distal fractures, both plates and nails are fraught with rest, and we must ensure that we do no harm by unnecessarily bending or adding metal which may not be relevant to the patient. Here, another badly comminuted fracture of the distal third with excellent results at the end of 8 months. You must understand that more the combination, faster the healing. And so, be it proximal fracture, middle shaft fracture, or distal shaft fracture, in tibial fractures, closed fractures, a cast is far superior to any other established or known method. Segmental fractures are a different ballgame altogether, and they always trouble the surgeon and the patient. If nailed or plated, one side will usually unite, and other side did not, needing additional procedures. Ilizarov certainly handles these fractures well, but the biological protocol is outstanding for these segmental fractures. I'm just presenting few examples to show you how beautifully they unite. We can see a segmental fracture. If it was open nailed, it was sure to cause a necrosis of the middle fragment. This patient has been walking from day 7. He is on his cast brace at the 4th month. And by 5th month, he had a solid union. Another patient with a comminuted proximal and a transverse distal segmental fracture. At the end of the union, you can see the knee and ankle are in the same straight line. And the patient is extremely functional and normal. A similar case of segmental fracture, the large central segment, which would have been difficult to manage operatively, has been beautifully molded in a cast and then cast brace. And at the end of the day, the patient has absolutely full function and the patient is near normal. So we must understand that segmental fractures do beautifully in non-operative methods of management. This slide shows one more compound segmental fracture with gross valgus, fibular fracture, double fracture of tibia, with wound, was cleaned, debrided, a cast applied, a window put, and it eventually healed uneventfully with beautiful results. Z effect or S effect or crisscross or scoliosis tibia is irrelevant to perfect function so long as the knee and ankle stay parallel to the floor. So you get an equal length. You get perfect movement of the knee, good movement of the ankle, and in addition, you also ensure that the patient does not have the risks of intervention, anesthesia, metal, infection, or other EO-induced disasters. One more patient for you. There we go. We must always remember that X-rays do not matter as long as joint axis is correct. And as the next slide will show you, in these sorts of fractures with short, incomplete segmental fractures, to complete them into a segmental fracture, we only need a nail to break it open and mess up the blood supply. Can any nail unite this fracture in 15 weeks? No. With a lock nail, despite dynamization, this fracture may take up to 6 months to 1 year, 1.5 years to unite. Whereas, here we have united so beautifully. We must remember the slight overriding does not matter. We are more interested in aligning the knee and ankle without angulation rotation. Overlapping or side-to-side union is, as a matter of fact, slightly better than end-to-end union. When end-to-end unions take almost a year to unite, side-to-side unions start uniting by 4 months and fully unite by 6 months. This one is an excellent slide. a grade 2B compound fracture with granulation tissue. The first picture shows a window in the cast through which dressing has been done, and the pictures on the left show the progress of how the granulation heals. The brace is deployed, the radiological completion of the course, as well as the patient with his leg is shown on the slide. Once again, Sarmiento slide, and the last x-ray is a follow-up of 23 years after this tibial fracture. This one had a bullet injury, and the last x-ray is a follow-up of 23 years. And here the patient, despite a 13 degree varus angulation and 20 degrees procurvatum, is doing extremely fine, fully functional, and no arthritis of either knee or ankle joint. One more slide, a compound fracture. You can see the wound, you can see the sutures. A small window was made, and the patient, you can see, is standing tiptoes and standing on his heel, and is very, very comfortable. Very important slide, take a screenshot, do not miss it. These are the key lessons for today. Acceptable varus and valgus are 10 to 15 degrees. Acceptable procurvatum is 6 degrees. Acceptable recurvatum is 5 degrees. Acceptable shortening is up to 2 centimeters. Rotation has to be corrected to match the opposite limb. And intoeing is not compatible function, and so must be taken care of on day one. I must add here, please, no plates in weight-bearing bones. Locked nails are for beginners. Ilizarov is for the learned. But cast and brace with walking is for experts. Do not feel ashamed that you are treating a tibia with a cast or a cast brace, because it needs much, much more orthopedic knowledge, technical skills, and intelligence to treat a tibia conservatively than to hammer in a nail in 20 to 30 minutes. One of our group members who has been following our methods has sent this, and you can see a comminuted fracture was cast and walked from day one, and it took less than 75 days is all that is needed for the fracture to unite properly. Thus we say, trust the power of nature, because you can see the patient walking. There's some problem with the video and we're not able to see the patient walking. So I should move to the next slide. A properly applied splint is compatible with all activities of daily living. You can see a young lady who has gone to a beach in her cast brace. She has been taking bath and getting into the sea with the cast brace. Later on, she leaves it out to dry when she is non-weight bearing and she's lying down on bed. And last picture is an x-ray which shows the status of her final union. So what are the key lessons for today? All extra-articular fractures of the tibia can be treated non-operatively. Complications, if any, are far less toxic than infected implants. Very, very important slide. You decide which is better. The one on the left with the plate, pouring pus, dead bone, rushing or referred to an Ilizarov surgeon, or one on the right, a window in the cast, dress him, walk him, and unite. Please remember, plates or metal does not unite, they only delay union. Walking and linear telescoping motion is the only thing that unites a fracture. So, please go ahead and do a locking nail if your EMI is outstanding for 3 months, you have just returned back from the EVO course, if you are younger than 35 years of age, if you are a fuzzy patient, politician, IAS officer, police, journalist, lawyer, or a Google-trained pest. Never operate on tibia for a friend or family, because non-operative tibial fractures do far better than all operated by official surgical practitioners of tibia. This talk I dedicate to my special friend, my very close friend, Professor Augusto Sarmiento, because when I told him I was doing a talk on closed tibia, he sent me 2000 x-rays and clinical picture, and I had a great difficulty in selecting the ideal ones for showing this lecture. I hope this talk has showed you a different perspective of treating tibial fractures, and I end this talk with a simple statement: please, please do not do any harm. Thank you very much for listening to the lecture, and I hope you are enjoying this and you will like this talk and should be using this in your real life day-to-day practice. Let me end the meeting.